So in this lecture, I would like to talk a little bit about the use of nuclear medicine at hybrid imaging and in infection. And we know that in spite of the major advances in antimicrobial treatment, new powerful antibiotics, infection is still a very important clinical issue. Timely diagnosis of any disease is very important, but timely diagnosis of infection is critical for appropriate imaging. We know that we have the morphological imaging modalities that have a very high resolution and allow us to to assess the anatomy or the lack of or the changes in anatomy related to infectious processes, but we know that they are limited in the early stages of disease or when there are additional pathologies in the same patient, like after surgery. We also all know that nuclear medicine is highly sensitive and allows us assessment of the entire body, but we are limited by poor physical characteristics and lack of anatomic landmarks. This is a list, but only a partial list, of clinical indications of nuclear medicine in infectious diseases. And for example, if we would go to South Africa or to the Southeast Asia, we would find additional very significant pathologies that they are confronted in their daily work. But we in the Western world deal mainly with musculoskeletal infections, with fever of unknown origin, cardiovascular infection, and soft tissue infection. What we would actually like from a radio tracer that would be ideal for imaging of infection would be that it should be very specific, only uptake in only sites of infection, that will allow us even to differentiate between infection and inflammation, that will allow us to monitor response to treatment, and that would be easy and rapid to prepare, safe, and if possible, also only low cost. What we have today are a number of agents, but for SPECT, the agents that are mostly used are gallium-67 citrate and leukocytes, white blood cells, labeled with either indium or technetium. There is a variety of additional agents, antibodies, and antibiotics, mainly that are used in some centers only or are research agents. And when we go to the PET part, we use mainly FDG for imaging of infection, with a few sites that use today gallium-68 citrate or ubiquitidine. Gallium-67 is around, citrate is around for almost 50 years. It's highly sensitive, but not specific because it has been taken up by many physiologic sites and also because it is also a bone and tumor-seeking agent. The problems with the limitations of gallium are also related to its physical characteristic, its low blood clearance, and the need for delayed imaging. Labeled white blood cells, mainly those labeled with technetium-99m, are very good for use with SPECT and SPECT-CT, and the imaging protocol is today defined by guidelines in our literature. FDG imaging, we know that inflammatory cells similar to malignant cells exhibit high intracellular levels of hexokinase and an increased expression of GLUT proteins with high affinity to FDG. The limitations are mainly related to availability and cost. So when we assess nuclear medicine studies in patients with known or suspected infectious processes, we first look at on a visual analysis to the presence, patterns, and intensity of tracer uptake. Quantitative analysis has not been validated on large-scale studies in patients with infection. We then localize the abnormal sites of uptake on the CT map and we need to make the final interpretation based on the clinical question, the history of the patients, and the additional tests that we might have available. False negatives are usually related mainly to the small size of lesions, to the low metabolic or functional metabolic rate of the process, or to potential interference due to lack of uptake due to administration of additional drugs. False positives can be related to artifacts, to physiological uptake of the specific tracer, to uptake in sterile inflammation, and uptake in known or unknown malignancies. So when should we use hybrid imaging in imaging of infection? In my opinion, always, but mainly in those cases that require good anatomical landmarks to localize the infectious process, to define the whole extent of disease, and in regions with complex anatomy, sometimes following previous invasive procedure. This is maybe the first study that was published by our group in the use of SPECT-CT with both gallium 67 and the labeled white blood cells in diagnosis and localization of infection 13 years ago. It included patients with osteomyelitis, soft tissue infection, fever of unknown origin, and vascular graft infection. And we see that moving to SPECT-CT, we significantly increased the specificity and the accuracy of our studies, but also the important fact was that in more than one quarter of our patients, SPECT-CT had an impact on patient care. So looking first at the use of hybrid imaging on bone infection, osteomyelitis, osteomyelitis of complicated bone, spondylolisthitis, and diabetic foot are the main scenarios where we have assessed the use of hybrid imaging. This is one case of a young patient with leukemia who presented with fever and septicemia and pain in his right leg. And on gallium SPECT-CT, we could detect the area of infection, but on SPECT-CT only, we could see that this was only a soft tissue abscess and this patient had no osteomyelitis. This is another patient, a paraplegic patient who had a pressure sore, an extensive pressure sore, you can see it here, in the left gluteal area. We can see the area of uptake on white blood technetium labeled white blood cells increasing over time up to 24 hours, which corresponded to an infectious process. Only looking at SPECT-CT, we could see that it was not only located in the soft tissue, but also there was involvement of the bone, and we diagnosed osteomyelitis. Moving to infection of joint prostheses, this orthopedic procedure is widely used all over the world, and infection can occur up to 2% of patients after primary implantation, and the incidence rises to up to 5% after revision surgery. The infection can occur at different times, early or later after the surgical procedure. This is one of our patients who had a subcapital fracture of the right femur, and she had hemiarthroplasty. She had an infected surgical wound. We can see it here. The question was whether the prosthesis was infected, and by SPECT-CT we could see the superficial wound, we could see the infected tract, and we can see that the infectious process is also involving the prosthesis. FDG, there are a number of studies that have been published using various criteria, and based on these various criteria, the performance indices were different, moving from 100% sensitivity but only 9% specificity to a more acceptable numbers. And I think that this is a very important schematic drawing of patterns of FDG uptake around the prosthesis in the hip. And this is actually the grade 5 when there is periprosthetic uptake. This is actually the most significant pattern that can suggest the presence of the prosthesis involvement in the infectious process. And this is one of our cases, a young lady who had a total hip replacement and revision of her surgery, and she had a known infected wound in the left thigh. But when we looked at the PET CT study, we can see that the uptake is around the prosthesis, as I have shown you previously. And this was actually, we reported it as involvement of the prosthesis by the infectious process, and this was removed by surgery. Spinal infection, the main procedure that has been performed today when spondylolisthitis is being suspected is white blood cells, is MRI. We know that labeled leukocyte study are inadequate because of the high amount of this area. The vertebra are rich in bone marrow and the leukocyte uptake. What can be used with SPECT CT is gallium-67. This is one of our studies where we diagnosed, we see the area of uptake. She was after, she had low back pain. We see the area of uptake, a number of areas of uptake on the bone scan, but this could have been also degenerative changes or fractures. We see the area of uptake on gallium planar scan, but only by SPECT CT could we actually diagnose the spondylolisthitis and the presence of an epidural abscess. And again, when we look at FDG imaging patterns, there are certain patterns, 3 and 4 here, you can see them here on the right, that are more significant or are consistent with the presence of spondylolisthitis. And this is one of our patients who had septicemia, back pain, a negative bone scan, and an abnormal FDG study at the lower cervical spine, corresponding to the pattern number 4, as you can see here. And our diagnosis of spondylolisthitis was further confirmed by MRI. Today, when we make the diagnosis, the patient is not being sent anymore for MRI as well. We gained our credibility. The diabetic foot, very important, because diabetes is the new epidemic of the Western world. And diabetic foot occurs in a large number of patients with diabetes, and osteomyelitis occurs in up to one-third of patients with diabetic foot infections. The problem is that it's not an easy diagnosis to make, since we have to differentiate it from soft tissue infections only, as well as from Charcot neuropathy. This is one of our patients that we assessed with white blood cells, SPECT CT. We see the area of uptake in the left forefoot, and we see that on SPECT CT, this area of uptake was actually involving the bone as well, and osteomyelitis of the fifth metatarsal bone was confirmed at surgery. And this is a patient in whom we did PET CT. This is the area of the known infected wound. But when we look on PET CT, it was only a process in the soft tissues, and there was no evidence of osteomyelitis, even on long-term follow-up. And this is an interesting patient, again, who had a non-healing wound in the left foot, and he was suspected to have osteomyelitis. We did first a bone scan because this was required, and we saw a number of areas of increased MDP uptake. On FDG, the uptake was localized only to one of the areas of the bone uptake. The others were sites of fractures, and this was the site of osteomyelitis. Moving to cardiovascular infection, this has really taken up lately. Suspected vascular graft infection is an important clinical indication because the only potential treatment for an infected vascular graft is removal of the vascular graft, and this surgery in these patients is associated with a large morbidity and mortality. This is one of our patients who had a pus-secreting wound in the left groin. This is a study that we still did with indium white blood cells, and we see that the graft was actually not involved in the process, in the infectious process. It was only a superficial infection. Paola Erba from Pisa has used technetium-labeled white blood cells for assessment of vascular graft infection, and she has actually found that SPECT-CT was the ultimate test and the best test with 100% sensitivity and specificity. Personally, I do not believe 100% in medicine, but it is definitely a very significant and good modality to use in this clinical scenario. And this is one of her patients with the right iliofemoral graft with infected wound, where SPECT-CT could localize this area of uptake to the graft itself. And this is what we do in recent days in our clinic. We do FDG PET-CT. We can see this patient who had a fempop graft implanted. He had a surgical wound at the lower anastomosis, and we can see that this the graft was involved in this infectious process. We know that FDG can be taken up also by various inflammatory processes, so we should be really careful how we interpret these studies. We did a study that was published a few years ago in the Journal of Nuclear Medicine and showed that FDG uptake was present in a large percent of non-infected graft, but it was never focal and it was usually of very low intensity. Endocarditis, again, an important indication. Studies provided to me by Paola Erba from Pisa. We can see this was a patient who had the mitral valve prosthetic implant, presented now with fever and septicemia, and we see on SPECT an area of uptake in the right heart. And surprisingly, it was endocarditis of the native tricuspid valve and not an infection of the mitral valve prosthesis. Also, in Pisa and not only in France as well, they use very much white blood cells, SPECT-CT for assessment of cardiac implants, of suspected infection cardiac implants, and can by SPECT-CT not only make the diagnosis of infection, but also localizes to the pocket or and the lead of this device. And this, the same can be done with FDG, as in this case where FDG PET-CT make the diagnosis of pacemaker lead infection. And because of the amount of data that has accumulated in this indication, today both white blood cells as well as FDG have been included in the European Society of Cardiology guidelines for assessment of the endocarditis and cardiac devices. Fever of unknown origin, again an important diagnostic challenge. Here again various tracers have been used. This is one of our young patients with leukemia who had prolonged fever and a negative workup. Gallium SPECT-CT, planar imaging diagnosed this area of uptake in the lower left chest, and SPECT-CT actually diagnosed an infected thrombus in the heart. that was only retrospectively identified on echocardiography. And this is another patient who had where an infected aortic graft had been removed and who presented again with prolonged fever and bacteremia. SPECT CT diagnosed the presence of a focus of infection adjacent to the vascular stump. With FDG, one of our patients with FUO, in whom we see this area of linear uptake around the heart, this was actually a patient who had an inflammatory process, idiopathic pericarditis, that was treated medically. And this is of our patients with FUO, we identified and localized areas of uptake in both adrenals, biopsy, diagnosed non-Hodgkin lymphoma. So there are some open issues that I would like to comment on them. First of all, we still are not very clear how much hybrid imaging in general and FDG imaging in particular can be used to monitor response to treatment. Some good work has been done by the group in Pretoria in South Africa, and this is just one of the cases that shows monitoring response to tuberculosis using FDG PET-CT. What we have looked at is whether antibiotic treatment affects that uptake of FDG, and we have shown that actually it has no clinically significant impact on the diagnostic accuracy of our test. Again, the problem of diabetes and infection and the fact that we are using labeled glucose with infection, and this is this could be a problem. Again, a few studies that we have done shows that it did not have the presence of hyperglycemia or of diabetes did not have any influence of the diagnostic accuracy of our studies in patients with infection. So we can and should perform FDG patients in patients with diabetes or hyperglycemia in question when the question is infection. We should have a few precautions that we should take care of. Make sure that we know that the patient has diabetes, try and schedule them in the early morning, still ask them to fast, but if they come with very high glucose levels, try and reschedule when possible. Should we use MR, PET-MR in imaging of infection? There might be certain clinical scenarios where it might be important, but it is definitely not a procedure that can or should be routinely used. So which should it be? Should it be PET-CT or SPECT-CT for infection? We have to consider the radiation doses. And there are a few studies that have compared the two in the same populations. These studies are very difficult to do. In diabetic foot and in endocarditis, FDG has a higher sensitivity. White blood cells usually has a higher specificity, as we can see in these three studies that I could find. I would like, for those who are interested in looking at hybrid imaging of infection, to note this issue that was entirely dedicated to hybrid imaging of infection, and where you can find some algorithms as this one that can show where FDG or SPECT-CT fit in the assessment of patients with infection in various clinical scenarios. And these are the guidelines that have been published by the ENM and SNM for the use of PET-CT and for the use of white blood cell SPECT-CT for assessment of infection. What is being done at Rambam is that for osteomyelitis, we use mainly white blood cells. For spondylodysitis and diabetic foot, we use mainly FDG. Arthritis, maybe we should use more FDG, and for children, because of the radiation doses, mainly FDG. inflammatory bowel disease, labeled white blood cells, infected heart, both of them, FEO, vasculitis, infected graft and sarcoid, mainly FDG. But gallium and white blood cell SPECT CT are very valid and good options. We need to know in our profession to be able to see the entire forest and not a single tree. And I hope that this lecture will help you a little bit. Thank you very much.